Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
The Great Convergence by Kishore Mahbubani, narrated by Wes Talbot. Introduction. Deep in our guts, we all know that our world has changed significantly. Indeed, the world has experienced greater change in the past 30 years than it did in the previous 300. What we are all struggling to find is the one big idea that explains what we feel. I believe that the concept of the Great Convergence explains the massive change we are experiencing. Since human history began, we have lived in different communities and tribes, and in different cultures and civilizations. Today, the massive forces unleashed by globalization are creating a new global civilization. Until recently, terms like North and South and developed and developing were used to describe the global condition. Today, the terms appear irrelevant. In a Financial Times column titled In the Grip of a Great Convergence, Martin Wolf said, quote, "Convergent incomes and divergent growth, that is the economic story of our times. We are witnessing the reversal of the 19th and early 20th century era of divergent incomes. In that epoch, the peoples of Western Europe and their most successful former colonies achieved a huge economic advantage over the rest of humanity. Now it is being reversed more quickly than it emerged. This is inevitable and desirable." End quote. The Great Convergence also explains the rapidly rising living standards of the vast majority of the world's population. Never before in human history have so many people been lifted out of absolute poverty, nor have there been so many entrants into the global middle class. Simple things like a flush toilet, electricity at home, a cell phone, a TV set, and a refrigerator have represented the aspirations of billions. For a long time, they seemed out of reach. Now many, if not most, people believe that these aspirations are achievable. One statistic exemplifies the scale of the change. Today, 500 million Asians enjoy middle-class living standards. By 2020, this number will explode to 1.75 billion, an increase of 3.5 times in 8 years. The McKinsey Quarterly Report of August 2012 provided equally dramatic statistics that the world is converging. Quote, "For centuries, less than 1% of the world's population enjoyed sufficient income to spend it on anything beyond basic needs. As recently as 1990, the number of people earning more than $10 a day, the level at which households can contemplate discretionary purchases of products such as refrigerators or televisions, was around 1 billion, out of a total world population of roughly 5 billion. The vast majority of those consumers were based in developing countries in North America, Western Europe, and Japan." End quote. After noting that by 2010 the number had reached 2.4 billion, the report continued, quote, "By 2025, MGI research suggests that number will nearly double again to 4.2 billion consumers out of a global population of 7.9 billion people. For the first time in world history, the number of people in the consuming class will exceed that number still struggling to meet their most basic needs." End quote. The world will have never seen anything like it. The human condition is not just improving in the material sphere. For millennia, peace was an elusive condition. Now, a long peace has arrived. The number of people dying in wars is presently the lowest it has ever been since statistics began to be kept. Until recently, it appeared that only North America and the European Union, EU, had abolished war from their soil. Now, the rest of the world is also converging toward peace. Major interstate wars have become a sunset industry. I can speak with great passion and conviction about this massive change in the human condition as I have experienced it personally. As a child in Singapore in the 1950s and 1960s, I lived in a typical third world city. Our per capita income was the same as Ghana's. We had no flush toilets, some malnutrition, ethnic riots, and most importantly of all, no sense of hope for the future. Singapore was then a British colony. No one believed that Singapore could become as prosperous as London. Yet the unthinkable happened. Now this impossible feat is being replicated in all corners of the world. We are building a new and better civilization. And we are also creating one world. Never before in history has humanity been so interconnected and interdependent. When Greece totters, Europeans are not the only ones who worry. Barack Obama knew in his guts that Greece could derail his re-election, and stock markets from Latin America to Asia, Africa to Australia, also fell. Greece was a tiny domino, but it could bring down larger dominoes because we have become fundamentally intertwined. Yet despite this, we still do not have the right conceptual structures to capture this new global condition. The nation-state was invented in 1648 with the Treaty of Westphalia, and it has served humanity reasonably well as an organizing concept, overcoming the old divisions of tribes and sects, clans and classes. But it is hard to believe that a human construct invented more than 350 years ago can serve humanity when everything has changed so totally. A simple analogy will explain this fundamental change. Before the era of modern globalization, when humanity lived discreetly in more than 100 separate countries, humankind was like a flotilla of more than 100 separate boats. What the world then needed was a set of rules designed to ensure that these many boats did not collide, and to facilitate their cooperation on the high seas if they chose to do so. This is what the 1945 rules-based order strived to do, and despite some obvious failures, it succeeded in producing a relatively stable global order for more than 50 years. Today, global circumstances have changed dramatically. The 7 billion people who inhabit planet Earth no longer live in more than 100 separate boats. Instead, they all live in 193 separate cabins on the same boat. But this boat has a problem. It has 193 captains and crews, each claiming exclusive responsibility for one cabin. However, it has no captain or crew to take care of the boat as a whole. None of us would sail into an ocean of rapidly changing currents and looming storms without a capable captain and crew at the helm of our boat. Yet the global policy community proposes to do exactly that: sail into the uncertain waters of the 21st century without a captain. Many of the major global challenges we face demonstrate well the degree to which all 7 billion of us sail on the same boat. The global financial crisis of 2008-2009 began with the collapse of Lehman Brothers in September 2008. Yet within months, the entire global economy came crashing down. No country could detach itself from the crisis because we were all in the same boat. The world came close to a total global economic meltdown in January 2009. Yet amazingly, few people are aware that total meltdown was averted only because a captain and crew emerged in time to take care of the boat as a whole. It happened at a G20 leaders meeting in London. Traditionally, all G20 leaders are programmed to put the interests of their cabins ahead of the interest of the boat as a whole. This is natural behavior. They are elected by their cabins, not by the boat as a whole. Yet, when they came to London on April 2, 2009, they clearly sensed that the boat was sinking. To save their own cabins, they had to save the boat. Hence, they mounted a major coordinated global exercise to bring the world economy back from the brink. They pooled all their resources and decided to stimulate the global economy with $1.1 trillion U.S. For all practical purposes, even though the G20 leaders will deny this emphatically, the G20 meeting functioned like a global government, and it performed well. Common sense would dictate that if all 7 billion people now live on the same boat, we should elect or select a captain and crew to take care of the boat as a whole. We have to create a global government of some sort, but not even the boldest political leaders want to mention the words global government. It is out of reach as a practical idea. The world's electorates are not ready for it. Still, there are times when we will need it. For the next century or more, the world will have to live with a slew of imperfect solutions for solving major and growing global challenges. Imperfect solutions can solve some global problems. In the late 1970s and 1980s, the realization that there was an ever-expanding ozone hole created by man-made chemicals called chlorofluorocarbons, or CFCs, spurred concerted action. Good sense prevailed, and in 1987, 43 nations came together to sign and ratify the Montreal Protocol, which aimed to phase out the production and use of CFCs. A decade or two later, the problem disappeared. The Montreal Protocol worked. In academic literature, the multilateral institutions like the UN and processes like the Montreal Protocol we have created to solve global problems are described as components of global governance. As long as a global government with mandatory powers is considered unacceptable, it is essential to strengthen cooperative institutions of global governance. But even as we do so, we should understand why global governance solutions are imperfect. This process is akin to sailing out to sea and selecting a different committee to manage the boat each time a new storm emerges. Moreover, the committee will inevitably be chosen after the storm emerges, not before. George W. Bush, probably the most unilateralist American president of modern times, resorted to the G20 only when it became clear that the economic storm was too big for the U.S. or the G8 to handle alone. We were lucky that the G20 could be assembled just in time before the world economy crashed. We may not be so lucky next time. Why? To strengthen institutions and processes of global governance, we clearly have to see a willingness on the part of different nations to make the necessary sacrifices to achieve global compromise and consensus. Even under normal circumstances, this can be difficult. However, we do not live under normal circumstances. We are living in an extraordinary period with massive changes taking place on several fronts. And all these changes complicate the efforts to strengthen global governance. Many of these geopolitical challenges are also a result of old thinking. They will not disappear soon. However, this does not mean that we cannot improve the systems for managing these rivalries. Here, a useful glimpse into the future can be provided by looking at Europe as a microcosm. The single biggest achievement of the European Union is not the story of its economic integration. It is simply the fact that the continent, which unleashed the two most disastrous wars of human history, has managed to achieve zero prospect of war. This is absolutely amazing. The existential question for all of us as we march into the 21st century is whether the modern world outside Europe can also match this European achievement of zero prospect of war. Ironically, Europe's imperfect record provides reason for hope. Geopolitical rivalries in Europe did not cease after the EU was born, nor have they vanished today. In the 1990s, several decades after the EU was born, Yugoslavia fell apart. Despite their superficial cooperation in the overt peace efforts, the separate EU states covertly supported their old World War II allies. In the initial phase of Yugoslavia's breakup, Germany supported Slovenia and Croatia, while the UK and France sympathized with Serbia. Adam Labor describes well these European divisions. Quote, "Not everyone in the UN wanted to cozy up with the Serbians, yet those officials who pushed for a tougher line to be taken were sidelined by peacekeeping officers, often British and French, many of whom simply felt more comfortable with the Bosnian Serbs. For years, London and Paris insisted on seeing the Serbs as the inheritors of Tito's multinational Yugoslavia, even as General Milosevic and his soldiers systematically destroyed it. It is Europe's shame that in the end it was an American, Bill Clinton, who finally took the decision to bomb." End quote. Indeed, they even sent arms covertly to their respective proxies. Yet despite all these tense geopolitical rivalries, Germany, France, and the UK never even came close to declaring war on each other. The big question is, why not? Here again, the answer is complex, but part of it is due to the fact that the EU states have accepted a rules-based order to guide their relations with each other. This order is made up of legal instruments and a complex political ecosystem that reflects the values of the European populations. Despite enormous geopolitical and other rivalries, there are major constraints on the behavior of EU states. Significantly, while there are some legal sanctions on violations of some rules and norms, the adherence to rules reflects values rather than fear of sanctions. There is no fundamental reason why this European ecosystem of perpetual peace cannot be shared with the rest of humanity. This is not utopianism. I have lived most of my life in Asia, indeed in the Balkans of Asia, Southeast Asia. When the Cold War ended, most of the experts expected the Balkans of Europe to remain in peace and the Balkans of Asia to explode into conflict. Instead, the exact opposite happened. The march to modernity in Asia has already begun to reap dividends of peace. The Association of Southeast Asian Nations, ASEAN, a mini-replica of the EU, played a critical role in delivering peace, just as the EU did for its member states. Optimism about the future is emphatically not equivalent to utopianism. We are far from achieving utopia. Major geopolitical and economic challenges continue to plague our world. Humanity has never progressed forward in a straight line. For every two steps forward that we take, we may take one or two steps backward from time to time. History will, as usual, zigzag. For this reason, this book will focus on many of the major geopolitical challenges we have to overcome. Continuing on autopilot is not an option. We have to work even harder to navigate geopolitical fault lines and use all the political skills and cunning, yes, cunning, we can muster to overcome these challenges. Ideally, we should try to reinvent the global institutional order to deal with this new human condition. But this won't happen. To put it bluntly, humanity lacks both the imagination and the courage to deliver bold new solutions. It does not help that political leaders continue to use old language and old concepts to explain the new world to their populations. One of the key goals of this book is to spark a new kind of discourse about the global condition. The Great Convergence requires nothing less. Fortunately, we do not have to wait until we have reinvented the world order to solve major geopolitical challenges. We can build on existing post-war models of cooperation to deal with them. And we can also work together to strengthen the 1945 rules-based order, including the UN and the Bretton Woods institutions, that has been a major gift from the West, especially America, to the rest of the world. Overall, there is no doubt that America and Europe have been good custodians of the imperfect but mostly positive 1945 rules-based order. However, there is change afoot on that front. The populations of America and Europe have shifted their attitudes. They used to support global institutions and global liberalization processes because they assumed that they would be the biggest beneficiaries of them. Now most fear that all the benefits will go to China and India. Hence, why should they continue to be custodians of this benevolent world order? The situation poses a sharp message to the new emerging powers. They have to step up to the plate and take on greater global responsibilities. They should stop pretending that they are still developing countries. If they do step up and agree to take on more responsibility, the West should welcome it. The headships of the International Monetary Fund, IMF, and World Bank may no longer remain European and American, but there will be more responsible stakeholders whose views on global order have begun to converge with the Western worldview. But will America begin to share power and work with the rest of the world in strengthening global multilateral institutions? America has long had an ambivalent attitude toward multilateral institutions. It has done as much to undermine them as it has to strengthen them. As long as the United States remained the strongest power in the world, such ambivalence did not lead to real costs for the country. However, with America facing the prospect of becoming the second largest economy in the world sometime soon, it may be wiser for America to change course and work to strengthen, rather than undermine, the 1945 rules-based order. Former President Bill Clinton put across this point well when he spoke at Yale University in 2003. Quote, "If you believe that maintaining power and control and absolute freedom of movement and sovereignty is important to your country's future, there's nothing inconsistent in that, the U.S. continuing to behaving unilaterally. The U.S. is the biggest, most powerful country in the world now. We've got the juice and we're going to use it. But if you believe that we should be trying to create a world with rules and partnerships and habits of behavior that we would like to live in, when we're no longer the military, political, economic superpower in the world, then you wouldn't do that. It just depends on what you believe. End quote. Clinton had wanted to say as much to America when he was president. However, as Strobe Talbot, then Deputy Secretary of State, documents in his book The Great Experiment, political realities prevented the president from speaking out. Quote, Clinton's view was diametrically opposed to Charles Krauthammer's concept of the unipolar moment, which held that the United States had a several-decade window of opportunity to get its way unilaterally, unencumbered by the need for consensus building and compromise, before the world became multipolar. Clinton believed just the opposite. What we had in the wake of the Cold War was a multilateral moment, an opportunity to shape the world through our active leadership of the institutions Clinton admired and Krauthammer disdained. But Clinton kept that belief largely to himself while he was in office. In public, and even in meetings with administration insiders and political supporters, Clinton's political instincts told him it would be inviting trouble to suggest that the sun would someday set on American preeminence. Ronald Reagan's optimism about morning in America had helped him defeat Jimmy Carter, who had, in the eyes of many, inadvertently associated his presidency, and therefore for some time to come his party, with the word malaise. End quote. Talbot goes on to remind us that Clinton could not mention that something like a self-governing world community would have to eventually emerge. Quote, for most of his time in office, Clinton was equally careful not to broadcast his belief in a version of Darwinism in its most optimistic form, the notion that globalization was conducive to the emergence, or evolution, of an increasingly cooperative international system. In off-the-cuff public remarks, in prepared speeches, and in private conversation, I heard him field-test the idea that the spread of democracy, open society, market economy, and individual empowerment was the wave of the future. An example came during a joint press conference in Beijing with President Jiang Zemin of China on June 27, 1998, when Clinton ad-libbed, quote, it is important that whatever our disagreements over past action, China and the United States must go forward on the right side of history for the future sake of the world. The forces of history have brought us to a new age of human possibility, but our dreams can only be recognized by nations whose citizens are both responsible and free. End quote. He stopped well short of endorsing the idea that something like a self-governing world community was a desirable outcome, not to mention a predetermined one. End quote. We now live in a different world. The unipolar moment, if it ever existed, has passed. Slowly, even the most unilateral minds in Washington are beginning to acknowledge that some global rules may actually benefit and enhance American interests. Again, as usual, it was an immediate geopolitical challenge that triggered this new thinking. Speaking at the Shangri-La Dialogue in 2011, Robert Gates, then Secretary of Defense, pressed China to abide by the Law of the Sea Treaty in its behavior in the South China Sea. This was a reasonable call. However, Gates was quite naturally embarrassed when someone asked him, when is the USA going to ratify the Law of the Sea Treaty? There is a lot of wisdom in the adage that people who live in glass houses should not throw stones. If America is going to succeed in persuading China to abide by global rules and conventions, it has to lead by example. This is exactly what happened. In May 2012, the Obama administration made a genuine effort to persuade the U.S. Senate to ratify the Law of the Sea Treaty. Secretary of State Hillary Rodham Clinton led the charge by saying that the treaty was, quote, critical to the leadership and security of the United States. U.S. interests are deeply tied to the ocean, she added. No country is in a position to gain more from the Law of the Sea Convention than the United States. End quote. She concluded by saying, quote, the United States is long past due in joining this convention. Our global leadership on maritime issues is at stake. I therefore urge the committee to give its swift approval for U.S. accession to the Law of the Sea Convention and ratification of the 1994 agreement, and urge the Senate to give its advice and consent before the end of this year. End quote. Even major Republican voices like George W. Bush and George P. Shultz, Secretary of State to President Ronald Reagan, supported U.S. accession to the treaty, which is still unratified. Why did Washington's Brahmins change their minds? Simple. The set of rules that America thought would only constrain it would now constrain a power that could become more powerful than America. This could happen sooner than most Americans expect. Indeed, almost no American knows that according to IMF data and in purchasing power parity, PPP terms, the American economy could become number two in the world as early as 2016. And who will tell the people that this has happened? The world will not end when America becomes number two, nor will it end when two centuries of Western domination of the world order come to a natural end. I have to emphasize this because the Western world is filled with new books that exude pessimism over the general global situation. Gideon Rockman succinctly captures the spirit of the Western mind with his appropriately titled Zero Sum World. As he says in his foreword, quote, "My prognosis for the future of international politics is undoubtedly bleak," end quote. Similarly, Ian Bremmer's book, Every Nation for Itself, suggests that the world is careening toward disorder. Charles Kupchin has a similar theme with his appropriately titled No One's World. Even The Economist has concurred that, quote, "West's growing pessimism is reshaping political life." 2 years after Barack Obama's hope-filled inauguration, the mood in Washington is as glum as it has been since Jimmy Carter argued that America was suffering from malaise. The Democrats' dream that the country was on the verge of a 1960s-style liberal renaissance foundered in the midterms, but the Republicans are hardly hopeful. Their creed leans towards anger and resentment rather than Reaganite optimism. Europe, meanwhile, has seen mass protests, some of them violent, on the streets of Athens, Dublin, London, Madrid, Paris, and Rome. If the countries on the European Union's periphery are down in the dumps, it is hardly surprising. But there is pessimism at its more successful core, too. End quote. By way of contrast, The Economist added that, according to the Pew Research Center, some 80% of Chinese, 50% of Brazilians, and 45% of Indians think their country is going in the right direction, whereas 31% of Britons, 30% of Americans, and 26% of the French do. Companies, meanwhile, are investing in emerging markets and sidelining the developed world. Go East, young man, looks set to become the rallying cry of the 21st century. Ironically, for a book that retains an optimistic outlook, it may well appear in print in the middle of a perfect economic storm in the West in 2013. In July 2012, former Treasury Secretary Robert Rubin warned that America was headed straight toward a fiscal cliff with a potential contraction of $600 billion a year, or about 4% of GDP, if Congress took no action to stop the automatic budget cuts by January 2, 2013. All this could trigger a double-dip recession in the U.S. Rubin warned that the uncertainty surrounding this could begin to affect decisions in the real economy. At the same time, another squabble in Congress over raising the debt ceiling could further damage market confidence. Such major uncertainty in America, coupled with major uncertainty over the future of the euro, could well deliver a perfect economic storm in 2013. I have lived through one perfect economic storm in the Asian financial crisis of 1997-1998. The prices of everything collapsed in Southeast Asia. It seemed as though the world was coming to an end. As we now know, it did not. Nor will the world come to an end for the West if it has to struggle massively to get out of a perfect economic storm. At the end of the day, the strong inner resilience of Western societies will come through in one way or another. So there is no reason for the West to be pessimistic. The West will not lose power. It will have to share power. And the 88% of the world's population who live outside the West want to cooperate with the 12% who live in the West. The massive new middle classes emerging all around the world have begun to accept many of the values and aspirations of the Western middle classes. In retrospect, this should not surprise us. Millions of the best minds from Asia, Africa, and Latin America have studied either in Western universities or, equally important, in Western-style universities in their own countries. Consequently, their perception of what constitutes good societies has also changed. In the past few decades, the world has produced the greatest flock of university-educated brains ever seen in human history. Never before have we nurtured talent at the scale occurring today. The rising tide of new talent is one of the key driving forces producing the Great Convergence. The hundreds of thousands of Asians, for example, who have been educated in American universities and who have returned home want to recreate the American dream of a stable and prosperous middle-class society. In previous centuries, when leaders met, they had to overcome their deep cultural differences. Some cultural differences remain, but it helps enormously when leaders of different countries have been trained at Harvard or Yale, Columbia or Stanford. And it is quite astonishing how often this happens now. We can and must take advantage of this new convergence to solve some of our world's new pressing problems. And it can be done. Chapter 1. A New Global Civilization. Humanity is one. That has always been a noble aspiration espoused by leading global thinkers, from Albert Einstein to Mahatma Gandhi. Einstein famously said, quote, "When we survey our lives and endeavors, we soon observe that almost the whole of our actions and desires is bound up with the existence of other human beings. We notice that our whole nature resembles that of the social animals. We eat food that others have produced, wear clothes that others have made, live in houses that others have built. The greater part of our knowledge and beliefs has been communicated to us by other people through the medium of a language which others have created. Without language, our mental capacities would be poor indeed, comparable to those of the higher animals. We have, therefore, to admit that we owe our principal advantage over the beasts to the fact of living in human society. The individual, if left alone from birth, would remain primitive and beast-like in his thoughts and feelings to a degree that we can hardly conceive." End quote. Einstein, in his usual brilliant fashion, was reminding us that we belong to a larger whole. Gandhi echoed a similar spirit with the remark, "All humanity is one undivided and indivisible family." Yet even as we listen to their exhortations calling on us to confer equal moral worth to each human being regardless of race, religion, language, or culture, few of us believe that we could improve the condition of humanity as a whole. Renowned Swedish economist Gunnar Myrdal explained well the general pessimism that the human lot could be fundamentally improved. Quote, "In recent years, there have been sudden, major changes in the world economy. They have radically affected the economic situation of all underdeveloped countries, though in different directions and degrees, and thereby the entire setting of the equality problem I am discussing in this lecture. For by far the larger part of the peoples in underdeveloped countries, these changes have been worsening their development prospects and in many countries are now threatening the survival of large numbers of their poor masses." End quote. Today, we can replace that zeitgeist of pessimism with a new zeitgeist of optimism. Without any grand strategy or a comprehensive plan of action, humanity has succeeded in creating a new global civilization. The goal of this chapter is to document in detail how the human condition has improved dramatically for the vast majority of the Earth's inhabitants. And this chapter will demonstrate how the world is becoming a more civilized place. We are killing each other less and less. We are understanding each other better and cooperating more and more. There is a lot of goodness about our world that has gone unnoticed. If present trends continue, as they are likely to, the human condition will become the best we have experienced since human history began. Fewer wars and combat deaths. Not only is the danger of war between any two major powers the lowest it has been in human history, there is now also abundant data to confirm that the number of people dying on battlefields is the lowest it has ever been since records have been kept. Quote, "The number of people killed in battle, calculated per 100,000 population, has dropped by 1,000-fold over the centuries as civilizations evolved. Before there were organized countries, battles killed, on average, more than 500 out of every 100,000 people. In 19th century France, it was 70. In the 20th century, with two world wars and a few genocides, it was 60. Now, battlefield deaths are down to 3/10 of a person per 100,000, end quote. The 2010 Human Security Report argues that long-term trends are reducing the risks of both international and civil wars. Andrew Mack, director of the Human Security Report Project and a former advisor to United Nations Secretary General Kofi Annan, comments, "The most reassuring finding is that high-intensity wars, those that kill at least 1,000 people a year, have declined by 78% since 1988. In the 1950s, there was an average of 6 international conflicts, including anti-colonial wars, being fought around the world each year. In the new millennium, the average was less than 1. Recent international wars have also been far less deadly than those of the Cold War era, and the major powers have not fought each other for more than 6 decades, the longest period of major power peace in centuries. France, the UK, USA, Russia, USSR, and India, in that order, were the world's most war-prone countries between 1946 and 2008, and that they have been involved in the most state-based armed conflicts. The demise of colonialism, the end of the Cold War, a dramatic increase in the number of democratic states, and a shift in elite attitudes toward warfare are among the key political changes that have reduced the incidence of international warfare since the end of World War II. Since the 1930s, public and elite attitudes towards war have changed substantially. Wars of colonial conquest would be unthinkable today, whereas in earlier eras, war was seen as acceptable, even desirable. Now it is proscribed except in self-defense, or with the authority of the UN Security Council." That was Andrew Mack, director of the Human Security Report Project. Equally important, argues Mack, has been the dramatic long-term increase in levels of global economic interdependence. Interdependence, he says, has increased the costs of war while reducing its benefits. Greatly increased levels of international trade and foreign direct investment have raised the costs of conquest and shrunk its benefits. One recent study found that, on average, a 10% increase in foreign direct investment reduced the risk of net conflict numbers by 3%. In today's open global trading system, it is almost always cheaper to acquire goods and raw materials by trade than to invade a country in order to steal them. Mack also points out that identifying the detriments of peace with any degree of precision is difficult, not because there are too few plausible explanations, but rather there are too many. This complicates the task of analysis, but the range of causes suggests that, other things being equal, the decline in interstate warfare is likely to prove enduring. Equally importantly, the UN, liberated from 4 decades of political stasis in the Cold War, led the huge increase in international initiatives directed at stopping wars and preventing those that had stopped from restarting. The UN was joined by other international agencies, donor governments, governments of the war-affected countries. Countless international and national NGOs were also actively involved. The strongest finding to emerge from statistical studies of the causes of civil war is that as levels of economic development rise, the risk of war falls. It is no accident that civil wars have been concentrated in the poorest countries in the world. Mack is not the only scholar to document this remarkable secular decline in wars and war-related deaths. Another study entitled Global Trends in Armed Conflict by Halvard Buhong, Scott Gates, Havard Hegre, and Havard Strand of the Center for the Study of Civil War, Peace Research Institute Oslo, PRIO, has also confirmed that, quote, "the number of ongoing conflicts has declined since shortly after the end of the Cold War, and the severity of armed conflict has generally declined since World War II. We are now in the longest period since World War II without interstate war, those fought between two or more countries," end quote. One statistic from Steven Pinker's The Better Angels of Our Nature confirms how dramatically the world has changed in the area of interstate conflict. Annual war deaths have fallen between 1950 and 2010 by more than an order of magnitude, from about 500,000 to 30,000 per year by one estimate. Many in the West live in fear of terrorist attacks, but even in the case of terrorist attacks, the probabilities are illuminating. According to Ronald Bailey, science correspondent of Reason magazine, an American was more likely to be killed by lightning, 1 in 5,500,000, or by a car accident, 1 in 19,000, than by a terrorist attack, 1 in 20 million, in the last 5 years, from 2005 to 2010. President George W. Bush used to say frequently, "We live in a dangerous world." He was dead wrong. Pinker provides a trove of data and argument to confirm that the world has really turned a corner in the field of war and conflict. As he says, since 1945, we have seen a new phenomenon he describes as a long peace, a concept coined in 1989 by the brilliant Cold War historian John Lewis Gaddis, who wrote a book of that name. Pinker describes how, since the end of the Cold War, a broader new peace appears to have taken hold. As I will describe later in this chapter, even corners of the world that have traditionally been perceived as dangerous, such as Southeast Asia, the Balkans of Asia, are experiencing a new peace that is both profound and durable. It is an undeniable fact that for most of human history, human beings treated each other terribly. Conflicts were frequent. With each conflict, more and more human beings were killed. The decline of senseless killing and the dawn of a new peace clearly mean that the world is becoming a more civilized place. With each passing decade, we worry less and less about being killed by a fellow human being. Surely, there can be no clearer standard of treating fellow human beings in a more civilized manner. Steady decline in absolute poverty and its effects. A second positive trend we are seeing globally is the steady disappearance of absolute poverty. At the turn of the new millennium, the UN set many new Millennium Development Goals, MDGs, to be achieved by the year 2015. Not all the MDGs will be accomplished, but one key MDG will be reached ahead of time, the halving of global poverty. A lot of this will be due to the rapid economic growth experienced by China and India in recent decades. But Africa is also contributing significantly to the reduction of poverty. The Millennium Development Goals Report 2011, published by the UN, notes that poverty continues to decline in many countries and regions. Quote, "Despite significant setbacks after the 2008-2009 economic downturn, exacerbated by the food and energy crisis, the world is still on track to reach the poverty reduction target. By 2015, it is now expected that the global poverty rate will fall below 15%, well under the 23% target," end quote. The U.S. National Intelligence Council is even more optimistic, projecting that global poverty will be virtually eliminated by 2030. A Time magazine article, quoting a report issued by the UN and the Overseas Development Institute, noted that, quote, "In 2010, about 1.4 billion of the world's 6.7 billion people lived in extreme poverty, which seems daunting until you consider that before the Millennium Development Program was launched, the figure was 1.8 billion. The 22% improvement rate is all the more impressive considering that it's been achieved in the face of a growing global population. Nearly 45% of signatory countries were on track to meet their goal of halving childhood hunger rates by 2015, and 75% have succeeded in bringing the number down in the critical under-5-year-old group. A whopping 95% of all countries have improved their under-5 mortality rate, with the worldwide figure falling from 101 deaths per 1,000 live births to 69." End quote. In addition to reducing poverty, many developing countries have made great strides in education. Sub-Saharan Africa as a region made an 18 percentage point gain between 1999 and 2009, the best record of improvement worldwide. Benin, Bhutan, Burkina Faso, Ethiopia, Guinea, Mali, Mozambique, and Niger have increased net enrollment ratios by 25 percentage points in the same time period. Targeted interventions have also been met with much success. Today, 12,000 fewer children are dying each day than in 1990. Between 2000 and 2008, improved first and second dose immunization coverage led to a 78% drop in measles deaths, which represents one quarter of the decline in mortality among children under five. The human condition is improving significantly in this arena, too. With all these dramatic improvements in the developing world, the world is becoming a less unequal place. The Center for Global Development, CGD, a think tank based in Washington, D.C., has produced a major report, edited by Charles Kenny, that describes the great convergence in quality of life between the rich and the poor states. Quote, "The next bit of good news regarding development is that looking at almost any measure of the quality of life except for income suggests rapid and ubiquitous global improvement. Since 1960, global average infant mortality has more than halved, for example. 9 million children born in 2005 were alive to celebrate their first birthday in 2006, who would have died if global mortality rates had remained unchanged since 1960, and the vast majority of those children lived in developing countries." End quote. The same CGD report makes another fascinating comparison, which strongly supports the Great Convergence thesis. Many in the West continue to believe that Africa made little progress in the 20th century and is not likely to make any meaningful progress in the future. Few expected that infant mortality rates would decline, life expectancy would go up, hunger would diminish, and literacy would increase. And yet, Africa is progressing well on all these counts. They will be shocked to learn, then, that even the poorest parts of the world are performing faster than they ever have in human history. For instance, between 1275 and 1775, the British population and wage rates stayed the same. In contrast, in the much shorter period between 1913 and 2000, Ghana's per capita income increased by 63%. We can see clearly here that even the poorest parts of our world are progressing faster than ever before in human history. The Ghanaian recent track record in development is even more impressive. Economist Jeffrey Sachs notes, "Ghana is on track to achieve most, if not all, of the Millennium Development Goals. It is one of the strongest performers in Africa on the MDGs because it has been investing for a long time in health and education, gender and equality, and it has made a lot of progress." The Christian Science Monitor also reports in a January 2012 article that, quote, "Ghana was one of the world's fastest-growing economies in 2011, with an annual growth rate of 14%, and it achieved middle-income status, according to the World Bank. Inflation has been on the decline in the past year, and the Ghana Investment and Promotion Council said that foreign direct investment, FDI, totaled $4.13 billion in the first three quarters of 2011, a massive increase from the level of investment in the same quarter in 2010, that was at $216.71 million. End quote. Charles Kenny eloquently states, quote, "Countries in every region of the world, from the poorest to the richest, with stagnant or vibrant economies, have all seen improvements in average levels of health and education over the past half century. Most countries, regardless of economic performance, have taken strides towards gender equality, civil and political rights. Progress in quality of life has been particularly rapid in countries previously the furthest behind. There are concerns. The picture regarding global violence is mixed. The quality of education in particular remains extremely low in many developing countries, and recent progress on health has slowed, not least because of the crisis of AIDS. Nonetheless, the overall picture from the last 50 years is of a planet with a growing number of people living a better life." End quote. One truly little-known feature of our contemporary world is that poor developing countries, including poor developing countries that have experienced traumatic internal conflicts, have begun to outperform some developed countries in the delivery of public services. Many years ago, the British government privatized its water authorities to improve their services. They did improve. Yet a water authority in a country that had just emerged from a painful genocidal experience outperformed all these British water authorities. That country was Cambodia. All this happened because of a remarkable man, Ek Son Chan. During the brutal rule of Pol Pot from 1975 and 1979, Ek lost his entire family and barely managed to survive. In 1979, when the Khmer Rouge was evicted, he worked in a municipal abattoir. He took over the Phnom Penh Water Supply Authority, PPWSA, in 1993 and transformed it dramatically, leading the PPWSA to outperform its British counterparts. As a result, he was awarded the Ramon Magsaysay Award in 2006, and the PPWSA won the Stockholm Industry Water Award in 2010. The Magsaysay Award citation describes well Ek Son Chan's tremendous achievements. It says, "Ek combed his bloated workforce for the best and brightest and set them to work, locating and repairing the system's myriad leaks, installing thousands of water meters, and closing hundreds of illegal connections. He installed a computerized billing program financed by France and persuaded other international lenders that his agency was a good risk." In 1997, the Phnom Penh Water Supply Authority, PPWSA, became an autonomous public enterprise. With major loans from the World Bank, the Asian Development Bank, and the Government of Japan, General Director Ek Son Chang embarked upon a major overhaul. He laid 1,500 kilometers of new pipes and expanded the authority's water output by 600%. He confronted VIP non-payers and cut off their water when persuasion failed, achieving a collection rate of 99% by 2003. He raised prices, resulting in strong revenues and an enviable reputation for paying the authority's debts ahead of schedule. With pricing policies favoring light users as well as subsidized connection fees and installment payment plans, he made cheap water available to the city's poorest neighborhoods. New and refurbished water treatment plants ensured that this water met WHO water safety standards. At the same time, Ek professionalized the authority's workforce, building its technical capacity and instilling in its employees a work ethic of discipline, competence, and teamwork. I lived in Phnom Penh for 1 year, not long before the Khmer Rouge took over in 1975. The city was shelled almost every day when I was there, as it was under siege then. Hence, I experienced firsthand the painful civil war Phnom Penh experienced from 1970 to 1975, before the Khmer Rouge took over. When the civil war finally ended in 1990, I expected Cambodia to emerge as a broken nation, with the country in danger of falling apart. On this unpromising soil, Ek Son Chan managed to deliver a public service comparable to the best in the world. Stories like his illustrate well the great convergence that the world is enjoying. A more educated world population. These positive trends are leading to a more educated world. The whole world is moving toward virtually universal primary school enrollment. As Joel Cohen, David Bloom, Helen Ann Curry, and Martin Malin describe, over the past century, formal schooling spread remarkably, as measured by the primary gross enrollment ratio, GRE, the ratio of total primary enrollment, regardless of age, to the population of the age group that officially belongs in primary education. In 1900, estimated primary GREs were below 40% in all regions except in Northwestern Europe, North America, and Anglophone regions of the Pacific. Within the past few years, the equivalent figure reached 86%. Over the 20th century, literacy tripled in developing countries from 25% to 75%. The spread of primary education is also leading to more informed citizens. To quote the CGD report again, people around the world are also more informed consumers than they used to be. They not only demand soap to wash their hands, they want schools to educate their girls, and they want governments that respect their rights. The increasing demand for education in particular is an important part of the story behind climbing primary enrollments. Less than half of primary-age kids worldwide were enrolled in school in 1950, but by the end of the century, the figure was closer to 9 out of 10. Valuing ABCs and getting DPTs, these are the forces behind global improvements in quality of life. In addition, the report explains, quote, "The proportion of the world's infants vaccinated against diphtheria, pertussis, and tetanus, the DPT shot, climbed from one-fifth to nearly four-fifths between 1970 and 2006, and ideas that save lives, wash your hands, don't defecate in the fields you eat from, are increasingly accepted," end quote. Education helps to improve the human condition. Steven Pinker suggests that as well as becoming better educated, we are also becoming more intelligent. Pinker describes this as the Flynn effect, which is the remarkable finding by the philosopher James Flynn that ever since IQ tests were first administered, the scores achieved by those taking the test have been rising. The average IQ is, by definition, 100. But to achieve that result, raw test scores have to be standardized. If the average teenager today could go back in time and take an IQ test from 1910, he or she would have an IQ of 130, which would be better than 98% of those taking the test then. More people joining the middle class. These rising levels of intelligence, education, and prosperity are in turn associated with a rising number of people joining the middle class. Omi Karas, a senior fellow at the Brookings Institute in the United States and an expert on the burgeoning middle class in developing countries, has defined members of a global middle class as follows, quote, "Those households with daily expenditures between $10 and $100 per person in PPP terms. This excludes those who are considered poor in the poorest advanced countries and rich in the richest advanced countries," end quote. The greatest improvements in history have occurred in the past 30 years, coinciding with the decision of China and India to open up and reform their economies in 1979 and 1991, respectively. As a result of this opening up of the world's two most populous countries, a staggering number of people are seeing their living standards improve, especially in Asia. Karas describes these changes well. Quote, "Asia accounts for less than one quarter of today's middle class, but by 2020, that share could double. More than half the world's middle class could be in Asia, and Asian consumers could account for over 40% of global middle class consumption. This is because a large mass of Asian households have incomes today that position them just below the global middle class threshold, and so increasingly, large numbers of Asians are expected to become middle class in the next 10 years." End quote. Indeed, figures highlight rather dramatically the extent to which Asia will soon become home to the world's largest middle class. In 2009, the North American and European middle classes were by far the largest on the planet, but in the space of just one decade, Asia will easily take their place. This should put to rest any doubts that the first five decades of the 21st century will experience a great transformation. We must keep in mind at this point that all the trends described so far, the decline of war, the rise of education, and burgeoning middle-class aspirations, tend to reinforce each other. As the European Union states have taught us, the development of middle-class societies and the decline of conflict are correlated. Human nature has not changed. Europeans have always been Europeans, at war or in peace. What has changed is the social order. As a result of modernization, people can improve their living standards and those of their children without having to resort to war. Indeed, wars leave societies worse off, not better off. This may well be the biggest contribution of George W. Bush in creating a more civilized human order. When the colossal military power of the U.S. could not easily crush a small state like Iraq, and when the U.S. had to pay massive material and human costs in trying to conquer and pacify it, this provided a living and daily demonstration of the futility of war. The Iraq War is estimated to have cost American taxpayers anywhere between $1 and $3 trillion, the estimate of Nobel economist Joseph Stiglitz. Living standards of Americans have been damaged by the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. Indeed, wars have become unfashionable. Australian historian Geoffrey Blainey once observed, quote, "For every 1,000 pages published on the causes of wars, there is less than one page directly on the causes of peace," end quote. Blainey is absolutely right. We have not absorbed the new reality that the human condition is the most peaceful that it has ever been. Nor have we really understood why this has happened. I suggest simply that the world is becoming a more peaceful and prosperous place because a consensual cluster of norms has been sweeping the globe and has been accepted by policy-making elites all around the world. Policymakers in all corners have essentially developed the same set of perspectives on how to improve and develop their societies. Greater university-educated populations. Even though there is increasingly broad agreement in the world on how to improve societies, it will still not be easy to unpack with precision what is included in these norms. But there are clues to where we might find the origins of such a global consensus. Let's begin by investigating leading North American universities, such as Harvard or Yale, Stanford or Carnegie Mellon. Although these elite campuses might once have been remote ivory towers that offered students and professors a cloistered and paralyzed life, isolated from the rest of the world, they are now places admitting hundreds of thousands of foreign students, especially from Asia. The resulting norms of these North American campuses have spread like a healthy virus across the globe. The numbers are staggering. The International Institute of Education, the IIE, in New York, has documented that in the year 2011, 723,277 foreign students studied in North American universities. This number included 157,558 from China, 103,895 from India, and 73,351 from South Korea. While more international students studied in the U.S. in 2011, less than 2% of U.S. college and university students studied abroad during the same period, according to the IIE report. This may explain why Secretary of State Hillary Clinton urged U.S. students to apply for passports and, quote, "not just think globally, but get out there and study globally as well," end quote. The world has learned a lot from America. Is America ready to learn from the world? The millions of foreign graduates from American universities, and to be fair, European, Canadian, Australian, and New Zealand universities, have returned home to replicate the Western university experience. As a consequence, our world now has the highest percentage of university-educated populations ever. China provides the most dramatic example. As recently as 1990, only around 3% of each secondary school cohort went on to university or another higher education institute. However, by 2010, less than 20 years later, China was able to increase the number of each cohort going to higher education to 29%. The Economist has reported that the number of students in China enrolled in degree courses rose from 1 million in 1997 to 5 million in 2011. The number of higher education institutions in China more than doubled from 2001 to 2011, from 1,022 to 2,263. By 2020, forecasts predict that China will account for 29% of the world's graduates aged between 25 and 34. A paper produced by the East Asian Institute of the National University of Singapore, NUS, provides more data on this absolutely remarkable transformation. It notes, enrollment in China's higher education has expanded rapidly since 1999. In 1995, only 5% in the age group 18 to 22 had access to higher education, putting China in the same rank as Bangladesh, Botswana, and Cameroon. In 2007, the ratio increased to 23%. The pace of expansion was unprecedented. Yearly tertiary student enrollment did not reach 1 million until 1997. A decade later, it exceeded 5.5 million. There was an increase of about 500,000 every year from 1999 to 2006. Thanks to the unprecedented expansion, China is now in the stage of mass higher education. With more than 20 million students, China has overtaken the U.S. in having the world's largest higher education sector since 2005. Similarly, according to the National Science Foundation Science and Engineering Report of 2012, India and China were the countries of origin for nearly two-thirds of the foreign science and engineering.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.